Hi, today we are going to learn about evaluation of bioavailability through pharmacodynamic method. So, previous video we saw about evaluation of bioavailability through pharmacokinetic method, which involves plasma drug time profile and urinary extraction method. And today we are going to see about pharmacodynamic method of estimation of bioavailability, which consists of two parts. One is acute pharmacological response method, and second one is therapeutic response method. Okay, acute pharmacological response and therapeutic response. So we'll see what is acute pharmacological response. See what it is given here. When bioavailability measurement by pharmacokinetic method is difficult, you need to go for this method when the bioavailability measurement is in pharmacokinetic method or by pharmacokinetic method is very difficult. In that case, or if it is inaccurate or non-producible, in that case you need to go for acute pharmacological response method, which involves change in pharmacological response. Let's say if you are using it for the heart, if the drug is for the uses of heart, then you need to see ECG reading. If it is for brain, EEG reading, electroencephalogram, electrocardiogram, electroencephalogram. If you are using any drug which is having a pharmacological response and pupil diameter, take the pupil diameter as acute pharmacological response, etc. Okay, it is related to the time course of given drug. So what is happening here is, take a graph. Let's say on y axis I will take pupil diameter and x axis I will take time. So as the time passes after the drug is given, what is the pharmacological response, how the response is, pupil diameter, it is going down, up, anything. So this type of graph you need to draw, that what it is saying. So bioavailability can be determined by constructing a pharmacological effect time curve. This is pharmacological effect is your pupil diameter, and this is the time curve, related to time curve. Okay, as well as dose response graphs. You can take dose response graph also. You give multiple doses and check whether how is the response. So this how you can draw the graph for acute pharmacological response. Acute, in short term, what is the pharmacological response I am getting, that what I am going to observe. Then the method requires measurement of responses for at least 3 biological half-lives. Remember, here also in acute pharmacological response you need to measure the biological pharmacological response for about 3 biological half-lives of a drug in order to obtain good estimate of AUC. So if you can measure the response till 3 biological half-life, then if you check the AUC, it will be in a it will give good results. Okay, so go at least for 3 biological half-lives. Now what is the disadvantage of this method? The disadvantage is the pharmacological response tend to be more variable, and accurate correlation between measured response and drug availability in the formulation is difficult. See, the pupil diameter, it is very variable. You can't exactly measure that. It keep on varying depending on many conditions. And also, relation of drug availability in the formulation to the pharmacological response is also very difficult as compared to your plasma drug concentration. See, we can relate directly, relate what is the plasma drug concentration and what is the response. We can relate that. But here, relation of that acute pharmacological response with the amount of drug present is very difficult. Moreover, the observed response may be due to active metabolite whose concentration is not proportional to the concentration of parent drug responsible for pharmacological action. What this point is saying is, there are some metabolites, drug metabolites, which show again pharmacological response. If that drug metabolite is having pharmacological response, then exact action of your parent drug and metabolite is not correlated. And also the concentration of drug which you are assuming, okay, you are assuming that, okay, this is the concentration of drug and this would be the response, but the concentration of metabolite is different and it is giving the response to that concentration, metabolite concentration. In such case, that correlation is very difficult. This is the disadvantage of this method. Next method is therapeutic response method. Acute pharmacological response visa. Now we will see therapeutic response. See, pharmacological response, the difference between these two methods is, we'll try to see the difference between these two. Pharmacological response, any response given by drug, okay. Therapeutic response is, if the patient is having, let's say, sugar, blood sugar level is high. If I give the drug, the blood sugar level decreases, we call it as a therapeutic response. Means we are therapy. We are giving therapy for that particular disease condition, and we are calling it as therapeutic response. Okay, this is the first difference, remember. So, this method is actually observing the clinical response of the drug formulation given in the patient. So, let's say if the patient is having blood sugar level, high blood sugar level, the drug which has been under investigation, that is for measurement of bioavailability, that drug is, what I am using is for treatment of high blood sugar level. In such case, what you are going to do is, you give the drug and measure the blood sugar level periodically. Give the drug, measure blood sugar level periodically, you will come to know, okay, what is the therapeutic response. Okay. The major drawback is the quantitation of observed response is too improper to allow for reasonable assessment of relative bioavailability between two dosage forms. So, yeah, let's say you are giving two dosage forms. Okay, I want to measure the relative bioavailability. So, what is your relative bioavailability? You are giving standard drug, sorry, you are giving the drug in the observation, and you are dividing its dose, or you are dividing its response, dose divided by what is the bioavailability, or what is the dose of your standard, so it is saying it is too improper to assess the relative bioavailability of two dosage form given, because see, one dosage form is giving one therapeutic activity, same drug, the response is more in one dosage form, response is less in other dosage form. In that case, the relation is very, very difficult. Say, what is relative bioavailability? You have drug and you have standard. Okay. So, standard, you can take oral standard as solution. I am giving drug solution and also I am giving tablet here. So, relating the therapeutic response between these two is not accurate. So, this is the disadvantage of your therapeutic response. So, this completes your pharmacological response, okay, method or pharmacological method for determination of bioavailability. Yeah, next part is drug dissolution rate and bioavailability. So, if drug is going to dissolve in the GIT, then only we will get good bioavailability, then only it will absorb. So, there is a good relation between drug dissolution rate and bioavailability. That is, your dissolution rate is a physicochemical property which has greatest influence on absorption characteristics from GIT. Okay. So, dissolution rate is a physicochemical property which has more effect on the drug absorption through the GIT, because if the drug is going to dissolute from the formulation, then only it can absorb. If there is no dissolution, there is no absorption, as simple as like that. So, the best way of assessing therapeutic efficacy of drugs with slow dissolution rate in vivo determination of bioavailability, which is usually done whenever a new formulation is to be introduced into the market. So, we already know that the best way to assess therapeutic efficacy of a drug whose dissolution rate is very slow, if the dissolution is very, very slow, then the best method is to conduct a bioavailability study in vivo. Okay. So, before introducing the drug into the market, we know this. We are conducting, because the drug if the dissolution is very, very less, then we need to conduct that study. What is that? Bioavailability, determination of bioavailability study in vivo. Okay, usually it is done for a new formulation. Old formulation, it is already been established. For new formulation, same drug, new formulation, you have to do this. Now, how we are monitoring batch to batch consistency? So what I am talking about now is, there is one formulation, already old formulation tablet is there for some X drug. Now I am converting, let's say, suspension. Drug is same, this is the old formulation, this is the new formulation, drug is same, suspension. Again, to know the bioavailability, if the drug solubility is very less, dissolution rate is very less, then what I had to do, I had to conduct in vivo bioavailability studies. Now the problem is monitoring batch to batch consistency and monitoring batch to batch consistency through use of such in vivo test is extremely costly. So just assume drug is same, formulation is different. For that, again I have to hold a person, I have to conduct bioavailability studies in human subjects. So it is very costly, it is tedious and time consuming, besides exposing healthy subjects to drugs, hazardous drugs. So these are the problems. What I am talking now is, instead of conducting bioavailability studies inside the body, can we conduct that outside the body? Yes, there is a provision. How and what, we will try to see that. Because the drug is old drug, see here, drug is old drug, we have old formulation, we are preparing a new formulation. So because the drug is old, I don't want to conduct again in the healthy volunteer, just to know what is the bioavailability. For that, I can conduct the same study outside. That is, it would be therefore always be desirable to substitute in vivo bioavailability test with inexpensive in vitro method. So what is that in vitro inexpensive method? Instead of conducting the bioavailability studies inside the body, I can conduct outside the body. See, this is applicable for only that drug which is having, for the formulation which is having same drug. So the drug is there in old formulation, I am preparing new formulation, so I need to conduct the bioavailability studies instead of conducting again into the healthy volunteers, exposing them to hazardous drugs. I can conduct the same study in vitro. What is that? The simple in vitro disintegration test is undesirable. So you can't go for in vitro test. The only available best tool today is, the best available tool today which can at least quantitatively assure about biological availability of drug in its formulation is in vitro dissolution test. So you can substitute in vitro dissolution test for in vivo bioavailability test, provided your drug is old and you are preparing a new formulation. In such case, you can substitute the in vivo bioavailability test with dissolution studies. So what is this, we try to see. So in vitro dissolution testing models. Now we'll clearly see, we came to know that in vitro dissolution is a tool which can substitute in vivo bioavailability test. So we can substitute this with in vitro dissolution test, provided there is a clause, drug is same, formulation is new. Okay, now for an in vitro test to be useful, it must be predict the in vivo behavior such an extent that in vivo bioavailability test need not to be performed. So if you can maintain that in vitro dissolution studies, whatever in vitro dissolution studies you are conducting, if you are maintaining the conditions which can mimic the in vivo condition, in such case you can directly go for in vitro dissolution studies instead of in vivo bioavailability. So what is that, we are going to see. So despite attempts to standardize the test performance, the in vitro dissolution technique is still by no means perfect approach. Obviously it is not a perfect approach, because we can't directly mimic whatever happening inside the body. The efforts are mainly aimed at mimicking the environment offered by biological system. We can't mimic everything inside the body. Only thing is, the environment which is being provided by the body is being mimicked here. That what the effort is been, efforts are being put to mimic only the environment produced by the body. That is temperature, one is content, whatever your GI content is, you can mimic that. We will see what are those. So there are several factors that must be considered in designing dissolution test. Yeah, I just said you can substitute in vivo bioavailability with in vitro dissolution test provided you fulfill these factors. One, factors relating to dissolution apparatus. What is it? Such as design and size of the container. So what is the size of the container? Okay, it will go from several ml to liters also. So what is its ideal size? Then shape of the container, whether it is round bottomed or flat bottom, we don't know. Then nature of agitation, stirring, rotating or oscillating methods. Which type of agitation method you are going to use? Speed of agitation, what is the speed of agitation you are going to incorporate there? Then performance precisions of the apparatus. So these are the apparatus factors which will affect in design of dissolution apparatus. So which type of flask you have to take, round bottom or flat bottom, which type of agitation you have to give, rotating agitation, stirring agitation or rotating, this is rotating agitation or oscillating agitation. So which type of agitation we need to incorporate. Next is factors related to dissolution fluid. What is that you need to mimic here? One is composition, whether it is water, 0.1 normal HCl, phosphate buffer, simulated gastric fluid or simulated intestinal fluid, where you are conducting dissolution. Yeah, another is factors related to dissolution fluid, such as you have water, you can take water into the beaker, you can take 0.1 normal HCl, you can take phosphate buffer, you can take simulated gastric fluid or you can take simulated intestinal fluid. What is that? Then its viscosity, its volume, okay, its temperature, then maintaining sink condition. What is your sink condition? Drug concentration in solution, maintained concentration at low level. So the in solution the drug concentration should be at low level, otherwise there will be no sink condition, or you are maintaining non-sink condition. Non-sink means gradually the concentration is increased. So this is the one factor related to dissolution fluid, which type of fluid you are going to take, 0.1 normal HCl or water or simulated gastric fluid or simulated intestinal fluid, don't know. Depending on the test where you are conducting, you need to select this. Next is process parameters, such as method of introduction of dosage form, how will you are introducing the dosage form into the dissolution beaker, sampling technique, how you are going to take the sample, then changing the dissolution, if at all it involves changing the dissolution fluid. Why changing the dissolution fluid? First, the drug, if you take the dosage form orally, first it is exposed to gastric fluid. After 2 hours, after gastric emptying, it will go to the intestinal fluid. So to mimic that, you need to change dissolution fluid also. So these are the three factors which you need to consider while designing the dissolution apparatus. Then the dissolution apparatus has evolved gradually, considerably, from the simple beaker type to highly versatile and fully automated instrument. So your dissolution apparatus is also evolving. First it has only a beaker type, now it is having highly automated type. Okay, then sophisticated automated type dissolution apparatus. So regarding the dissolution, I made a full chapter regarding this. Dissolution chapter, what is Nyquist-Whitney equation, everything, you can go and check that part. I will give the link in iCard. Then based on absence, okay, the device can be classified into number of ways. How the device, dissolution apparatus can be classified into number of ways? What is that? Based on the absence or presence of sink conditions, there are two types of dissolution apparatus. Whether the sink condition is there or not, depending on that, we have two types of dissolution apparatus. They are, one is closed compartment apparatus. Closed compartment means there will be one beaker like this. So there will be one beaker like this. It will be closed, and whatever you are doing, you will be doing only in this beaker. So with this type, we call it as closed compartment apparatus. Second one is open compartment apparatus. It contains like this. There will be a cell and there will be a provision where you will keep your dosage form. Let's say our dosage form is tablet, we keep your dosage form. Here continuously dissolution fluid is flowing. So what is happening here? Continuously new fluid is introducing. Our new dissolution medium is coming in touch of your dosage form. We call it as a sink condition. We call this as a flow through cell. Because it is flowing through this flow through cell, this is your dosage form. Okay. So this is the closed compartment and this is the open compartment, because it is open at the both side. See here. So regarding closed compartment, it is basically a limited volume apparatus. I said you take a beaker, whatever the volume you have taken is limited there, will maintain under non-sink condition, because you can't introduce a new dissolution medium here, because that beaker capacity is constant. Then dissolution fluid is restrained to the size of the container. Obviously, if you take 2 liter container, 2 liter of dissolution fluid. If you take 1 liter container, 1 liter of dissolution fluid. That is beaker type apparatus. Okay. Then open compartment apparatus, it is the one in which the dosage form is contained in a column. I said to you, there will be a column like this, container brought in continuous contact with the fresh flowing dissolution medium. Perfect sink condition. This how it will brought into the contact with the dissolution. There will be one column where we have our dosage form. This is the dosage form. Every time the fresh dissolution medium, so it will be, flow will be like this. From here, it will come out from here. Okay, this how you maintain the open compartment apparatus. Now, third type is called dialysis system. You can use this dialysis system where, in case where there is very poor aqueous solubility of the drug, yes sir. Whatever the drug you got is having very poor aqueous solubility, in such case you can use dialysis system. Remember GPAT question, which type of dissolution apparatus is used for poorly soluble drug, that is very poorly soluble drug, not poorly, very poorly soluble drug, that is dialysis system type dissolution apparatus you are going to use. Okay, here we will discuss only official methods. What are those official methods? We'll try to see. So one is rotating basket type. Okay, it is basically a closed compartment beaker type apparatus comprising a cylindrical glass vessel with hemispherical bottom 1 liter capacity like this. Bottom will be, I will just try to draw this. Okay, so the bottom will be hemispherical like this. So this is your hemispherical bottom. Okay, and the capacity will be 1 liter. So the capacity is 1 liter. So that how this dissolution apparatus, this is there in especially this is the common type of dissolution apparatus where you can see this in many of the colleges. So I will try to show you that. See, this how it looks. Okay, then partially immersed in water bath, so that whatever, I will try to draw that here. Whatever the apparatus hemispherical is there, it is partially immersed in water. Partially it is immersed in water, okay. Maintained at body temperature, that is 37 degree centigrade. Then a cylindrical basket made up of 22 mesh to hold a dosage form. So there will be a basket type like this. There will be a mesh. So it is made up of, the mesh number is 22. So you can use 22 mesh to hold the dosage form. So there will be a basket like this mesh. You put your dosage form here. Tablet is kept into the basket. Okay. Located centrally in the vessels. Here, the basket is rotated centrally here. Okay. In the vessel at a distance of 2 centimeters from the bottom. From the bottom 2 centimeters. And rotated by variable speed motor. So there will be, assume like this, okay, there will be one basket which has been, there is a shaft. In this basket you are going to keep your dosage form, and you start rotating it. The basket should remain in motion during drawing of sample also. All metal parts like basket and shaft are made up of stainless steel. So there will be a basket provision. In that basket you will add your drug, and that basket will be rotating like this. Okay, and that hemispherical beaker is being dipped into a water bath partially, and that water is being maintained at body temperature. Then we have second type of apparatus, okay, that is paddle type. First type we saw about basket type apparatus one, then we have about paddle type. See here. So basket type apparatus, it will be like this. So this one is this one is basket type and this one is paddle type. We have hemispherical, we have basket here with mesh 22, okay, dissolution medium which is been immersed, and we have 1 liter flask. Everything is given in the diagram. This is the basket type. Here we'll take paddle type. Here the in the basket type we'll put drug here. Here the dosage form is been placed, but in the paddle type we keep, this is the dosage form. We just immerse the dosage form here. Okay, and the paddle will be rotating, which will produce the churning motion, okay, through which there will be a fresh dissolution medium is churned throughout the basket. So it will be churned throughout the basket and the dissolution will takes place. Okay, so this how your type 1 and type 2 apparatus looks like. That how we know currently we use this dissolution in many ways. Okay, so there are many dissolution apparatus available, so basket and paddle. It is there in all the colleges. It is a normal dissolution apparatus which is available in all the colleges. Now what is the main important thing here is to substitute this dissolution apparatus or dissolution testing as a bioavailability testing. Okay, to substitute this dissolution testing as a bioavailability testing, you need to have one correlation, that is in vivo in vitro correlation. What I mean by this, because you are conducting the studies inside the body and you are conducting the studies outside the body, same studies you are conducting outside the body and the same studies you are conducting inside the body, they should have same correlation. What do you mean by that in vitro in vivo correlation? To tell you in a simple manner, I can draw like this. On x axis I will take percentage cumulative drug release, that is in vitro. This is in vitro. Whatever percentage cumulative drug release I got through in vitro dissolution, I will keep on x axis. On a y axis I will take in vivo blood plasma concentration. So I will take, on y axis I will take blood plasma concentration. What we are doing here is take two tablets of the same drug, same company, everything is same. One you keep in the dissolution apparatus, other one you give to the patient. Here you conduct the dissolution studies, you get percentage CDR. Put that percentage CDR on x axis. Now other tablet is been given to the patient and you are conducting plasma level time studies. So you get blood plasma concentration, that you keep here. Now when you draw the graph, both blood plasma concentration, let's say blood plasma concentration, I will draw in red. So this is the blood plasma concentration graph which you are getting, and let's say the blue one indicates percentage CDR. Now if I try to draw the line, what is happening here, both blood plasma concentration and percentage CDR in the same line, means what? Both are correlated. Why both are correlated? Because you maintain same condition in vitro which is mimicking in vivo, you will get this correlation. This is called in vitro in vivo correlation. If this correlation is there, then you are very good to go to conduct the bioavailability studies outside the body. If the correlation is deviating, you are getting like this and like this, deviating, then gone. So there should be good correlation between in vitro and in vivo studies. That is what in vitro in vivo correlation is. So why we are doing this correlation? See here, there are two major objectives developing such correlation. What is those objectives? One, to ensure batch to batch consistency in the physiologic performance of drug by using in vitro values. So batch to batch there will be consistency in bioavailability. How can I do this? For each and every batch, I can't conduct bioavailability studies by taking patients. Instead of that, I will substitute those bioavailability studies by conducting the studies as in vitro dissolution studies. Then, two is to serve as a tool. In the development of new dosage form with desired in vitro performance. Let's say you want to develop a new dosage form for old drug with the desired dissolution performance. Each and every time you need not to conduct bioavailability studies, you can directly go to the in vitro studies. So by having in vitro in vivo correlation, this is the advantage. Next, there are two basic approaches by which the correlation is being done. One approach I already told you. What is that approach? You take percentage CDR and drug plasma concentration, CR. Correlation based on plasma level data. So in one axis you take plasma concentration, other axis you take percentage CDR. So in the percentage CDR, what we will get, see here. Here the linear relationship between dissolution parameters. What is the dissolution parameters which are linear relation? Is percentage drug dissolved, one, rate of dissolution, rate constant of dissolution, etc. should be in correlation with plasma level data parameters such as drug absorbed, percentage drug dissolved is percentage drug absorbed, rate of dissolution is rate of absorption, Cmax, Tmax and rate of absorption constant are developed. For example, percentage drug dissolved versus percentage drug absorbed. See here, we can take this thing, percentage drug dissolved in x-axis and percentage drug absorbed. What do you mean by percentage drug absorbed? Amount of drug present in the plasma concentration, the drug concentration in the plasma, or amount of drug present in the plasma. So this how you can correlate. If you get a straight line for this, both forming in the same straight line, if there is a good correlation, you can go ahead. Another type of correlation is, one type of correlation is blood plasma. Another type of correlation is urinary extraction method. Here dissolution parameters are correlated with amount of drug excreted unchanged through urine. So cumulative amount of drug excreted has a function of time. So that what we will do. So amount of drug excreted through urine on y-axis and dissolution percentage drug dissolved on x-axis. How much drug is dissolved is that much of drug is excreted. If it is correlated, then we can say that the in vitro and in vivo correlation are done. So remember, in vitro in vivo correlation you can do by plasma concentration, percentage drug dissolved, or urinary extraction, amount of drug unchanged in the urine to the drug percentage drug dissolved. Another type of correlation is based on a pharmacological response. Based on a pharmacological response, percentage drug dissolved, we take LD50 here and we take percentage drug dissolved, get good correlation. So pharmacological response we will see. How much drug is dissolving in the dissolution medium in vitro. So that much amount of drug will absorb and show its pharmacological action. So that pharmacological action which has been shown is taken on y-axis, drug dissolved is taken on x-axis, you can good to correlate them. Okay. Then statistical movements theory can also be used to determine the relationship such as mean dissolution time versus mean residence time. Okay, see here, you can take mean dissolution time here, then mean residence time here, and also you can correlate. So four type of correlation you can get here. Okay, so one is plasma, one is urine extraction, another one is pharmacological response, and the fourth one is statistical movements theory, which says mean dissolution time and mean residence time correlation, correlate this two time here. Okay, though examples of good correlations are many, if there are good correlations are there for many of the drug, there is an instance when positive correlation is difficult or impossible. Sometimes it has some problems. For example, in case of corticosteroids, the systemic availability may not depend upon dissolution characteristics of the drug. So in case of corticosteroids, what happens in dissolution, we are saying that okay, drug is dissolving very good, dissolution rate is very good, but when we go to the systemic absorption, that absorption is not dependent on the dissolution characteristics. See, if the drug is absorbing through active absorption, then the drug is not depending on the dissolution. Even though how much drug is present in the blood plasma, in the stomach, the absorption, because it is active, So there will be a rate limiting by the active absorption. If it is only passive absorption, then you can apply this. Okay, then several factors that limit such as correlation include, which will limit the correlation, include variable pertaining to drugs, such as what is the factors which will limit this correlation is drug dissolution methodology, in which methodology the drug is dissolving, physicochemical properties of the drug such as particle size, physiological variability like pre-systemic metabolism. So all these factors will affect, even though there are so many factors which will affect, but we got good correlation. So in such case we can go for bio waiver. What do you mean by bio waiver? Instead of using biological or using a human being for the bioavailability, you can use in vitro dissolution test for the bioavailability. Okay, this completes what are the part in the bioavailability. Next part we are going to see about bioequivalence. I hope you understand. Thank you.